Welcome to the Bayard Rustin Crown Forum. Dr. Rice said this is the first of an annual event. My name is Bummah Ndeh, and I'm a senior economics major from Silver Spring, Maryland. I am the president of Morehouse College Safe Space, our LGBT student collective, as well as the co-director for the Bayard Rustin Scholars Program, which was established in 2012. So I just want to get into Bayard Rustin a little bit in case you will go into that more. Bayard Rustin was a leader, a mentor, and a civil rights activist. Though he dedicated decades of his life to civil rights movement building and to changing history for the better, his contributions and his name remain in the shadows and footnotes of time. This is because Rustin lived as an openly gay man, a bold, beautiful, black gay man. Bayard Rustin was a brother outsider. Similar to Bayard Rustin, we have many brothers and sisters right here at Morehouse and in the AUC who feel like brother and sister outsiders. We attend an institution where we often boast of the accomplishments of our alumni and current students without recognizing that many of them are gay, bisexual, queer, trans, or gender non-conforming. These students always have and always will lead and achieve in all capacities and positions. Moving beyond all the accomplishments, though, the underlying truth is that we attend an institution that is unsure of whether or not it wants to really value our black, gay, bisexual, queer, trans, and gender non-conforming identities. If at Morehouse we are striving towards creating a world of our dreams, then we must ask ourselves, who are we leaving behind? It's clear there's much work to be done, but I'm grateful for the many people here from administration on down to the students who are truly trying to make Morehouse a more inclusive environment. This very event would not be possible without people like Dr. Rice, Dean Carter, and Dean Washington, and also alumni like Marcus Lee, Jamal Lewis, Kenneth Pass, Daniel Edwards, Brandon Crowley, and so many more before me who for years pushed the school to honor Bayard Rustin with a portrait in this chapel and to have this event. To them, I say thank you, and thank you. The purpose of this event is for you to leave here with a better understanding of who Bayard Rustin was, and more importantly, to push your understanding of how we at Morehouse can be not tolerant, but more embracing of the LGBTQ community. And I do want to stress how important it is for people who identify with the queer community to be the ones leading this conversation. We do all this while moving forward towards a spirit of celebration for the upcoming Pride Week 2016, hosted by the Morehouse Safe Space. And at this time, I would like to ask for the e-board members of Morehouse Safe Space to please stand and be recognized. If we have members of the LGBTQ task force, please stand and be recognized. Thank you. And if you're proud to be gay, bisexual, queer, trans, gender non-conforming, or just different, please stand and be honored. Woo! Thank you for simply being you. And now I would like to invite Casey Quinlan to the podium.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Casey Fenora, a senior history major from Orlando, Florida. A close advisor to Martin Luther King and one of the most influential and effective organizers of the civil rights movement, Bayard Rustin was affectionately referred to as Mr. March on Washington by A. Philip Randolph. Born on March 17, 1912, Rustin was one of 12 children raised by his grandparents, Jennifer and Julia Rustin, in Westchester, Pennsylvania. Rustin's lifelong commitment to nonviolence began with his Quaker upbringing and influence of his grandmother. After graduating from Westchester High School, Rustin studied intermittently at Wilberforce University, Cheney State Teachers College, and the City College of New York. While a student at State College of New York in the 1930s, Rustin joined the Young Communist League, drawn to what he believed was communist commitment to racial justice. Rustin left the organization when the Communist Party shifted their emphasis away from civil rights activity in 1941. Shortly after his YCL departure, Rustin was appointed youth organizer and proposed the 1941 March on Washington by trade union leader A. Philip Randolph. During this period, he joined the Fellowship of Reconciliation and co-founded the Congress of Racial Equality. Despite his successful tenure with FOR, Rustin was later asked to resign from the organization, quite frankly, for having sex in the backseat of a car. During World War II, he spent more than 2 years in prison as a conscientious objector. In 1947, Rustin was arrested with other participants of CORD's Journey of Reconciliation, a test of the Supreme Court's ruling barring segregation and interstate travel that provided a model for the freedom rides of 1961. After spending 22 brutal days on a North Carolina chain gang, Rustin published a report in several newspapers that reformed the practice of prison chain gangs. In 1948, Rustin went to India for 7 weeks to study the Gandhian philosophy of nonviolence. Rustin became a key advisor to King during the Montgomery bus boycott. He provided King with a deep understanding of nonviolent ideas and tactics at a time when King had only an academic familiarity with Gandhi. King recognized the advantages of Rustin's knowledge, contacts, and organizational abilities and invited him to serve as his advisor, as well as Rustin's background would be controversial to other civil rights leaders. In 1963, A. Philip Randolph began organizing a march on Washington for jobs and freedom. Despite the concerns of many civil rights leaders, Rustin was appointed deputy director of the march. In less than 2 months, Rustin organized the event, which would bring over 200,000 participants to the nation's capital. From 1965 until 1979, Rustin served as president and later co-chair of the A. Philip Randolph Institute, an organization for black trade unionists dedicated to racial justice and economic justice. During the 1970s and 1980s, Rustin served on many humanitarian missions, such as aiding refugees from communist Vietnam and Cambodia. He also testified on behalf of the New York State's 1986 Gay Rights Bill. From this position, Rustin promoted his view that future progress for African Americans rested on alliances between blacks, liberals, labor, and religious groups. The Bayard Rustin Scholars Program, founded in 2012, was designed to foster social justice advocates to carry the ideals of the human rights activist Bayard Rustin. Our vision is to teach students how to be effective social advocates for marginalized groups while using the philosophy of Rustin as a model for teaching for reaching this goal. Rustin's model includes nonviolent tactics, democratic procedures, and a respect for human rights. The Bayard Rustin Scholars Program also participates in activities that identify with each focus area during the course of the academic year. And now I will welcome back Bummah Ndeh to the stage.
So earlier I mentioned the idea of getting by Rustin's portrait in King Chapel, and today I'm happy to announce that the idea will soon be happening. Dean Carter, along with many others, have committed towards raising the necessary funds for the painting of Bayard Rustin. And that is to be unveiled. That is to be unveiled in spring 2017 at the second Bayard Rustin Crown Forum. Thank you so much again to those people for making this happen. And in publicly announcing this commitment, we can now hold them accountable. But I'm sure that they will willingly do the work necessary to see this project through by then. So now I'd like to introduce you to our keynote speaker, Darnell L. Darnell Moore is a senior correspondent at Mike and co-managing editor of the Feminist Wire. He is the host of a new digital series called The Movement. His writing draws connections between race, gender, sexual identity, and power. Along with Wade Davis, he co-founded You Belong, a social good programming and consulting firm. He also co-organized, along with Patrice Cullors, the 2014 Black Lives Matter ride to Ferguson, and organizes with Black Lives Matter New York City. Quick note, for those of you who don't know, two of the co-founders of the Black Lives Matter movement are actually queer Black men. He is presently a writer in residence at the Center on African American Religion, Sexual Politics, and Social Justice at Columbia, and is working on completing his first book. So please join me in welcoming Darnell Moore.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's an honor to be here, particularly because while I'm not a Morehouse grad, I'm in community with so many amazing Morehouse folk who are doing great things in the world. So I trust that I'm in the room with people who are going to do the same. So I want to start, before I even give my words, to thank the student organizers who put this together and fought hard to make sure that an event like this took place. Thank you so much. And also to the dedicated faculty and staff. But let me jump right in. I was trying to think of a title that I would use for this occasion, and I couldn't settle on one. So I have a few thoughts. First, we can't get free without each other. That's the first note. The second, we are all in this thing together. And the third, I'm borrowing from an article I recently wrote and published that was called, "You Are Not My Leader If You Don't Love Me." I like that. What an honor to gather collectively under the name and legacy of Bayard Rustin, a Black freedom fighter and civil rights movement architect who was arrested and imprisoned once in Pennsylvania from 1944 to 46 for conscientiously objecting to serving in World War II because he was a Quaker. Many of us might find reason to honor those like Rustin who perform seemingly respectable, righteous, and reputable acts of protest when opposing state violence. But in 1953, Rustin would also spend another 60 days in a jail cell in Pasadena, California, after a judge charged him with performing a lewd and lascivious act in public. Rustin was caught having sex with two men in a parked car. In the minds of some of us here today, his actions might not calculate as that which is becoming of the type of respectable, righteous, and reputable Black leader we've come to imagine and praise. How could they, when our conceptions of respectable, righteous, and reputable leadership are too often anchored in visions of Black men dressed perfectly in their Sunday's best, with pants pulled up so as not to sag, ready to perform a type of Black excellence that in some cases we think can stop a police officer's bullet, right, or a hiring manager from throwing away our resumes when they are topped with names that sound too Black and too hood. Right. Rustin, you might think, is in no way the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Rustin is more Baldwin, yes, than he is Abernathy, C.K. Steele, John Lewis, Eldridge Cleaver, Huey Newton, Amiri Baraka, Otis Morse III, or Umi Sela. Rustin, in our minds, might be a seeming outlier, a deviant, a homosexual, a queer, a lover of men, one lover in particular who was a white man. How then is it possible for someone like Rustin to receive the type of acclaim and honor afforded to the typically imagined black leader when heterosexuality, performances of masculinity, swag, bravado, manhood, gender conformity, and cisgenderedness are the objects through which we vision many of our leaders today? Leaders who are never gay, never queer, never femme-performing, sometimes women if they aren't aggressive butch lesbians, maybe bisexual, never intersex, and definitely not transgender. This is why I am elated and so honored to stand here before you in the name of a black, gay, deviant, disreputable, brilliant mastermind organizer of an ancestor who did way too much, for all of us black folks to be blotted out of our collective memories and histories. I'm grateful for the students, faculty, and staff who are adamant that in this black presence, in our black futures, the fire this time will not be suppressed by a Bayard Rustin Redux. Those of you who are adamant that in this iterative moment of the long struggle for black liberation, we will not allow a 2.0 version of black invisibility to stifle our quest for collective freedom. I'm grateful that we are gathered here upon the occasion of remembering a pragmatic black leader who once remarked, "If we desire a society without discrimination, then we must not discriminate against anyone in the process of building this society." I am grateful that we have this time to reflect and imagine differently because I have encountered too many black folk whose freedom dreams happen to be someone else's nightmare.
My.
To be sure, I am certain that if I were to ask you, how many of you truly believe that black lives matter? In fact, most of you in this room would probably respond accordingly. In fact, how many of you believe that black lives matter in this room? How many of you have actually participated in Black Lives Matter themed events? Raise your hand. How many of you have shared the hashtag on social media, wrote Black Lives Matter on poster paper, argued why it is right and just for you to assert Black Lives Matter in a society that has taught you that all lives matter except for yours? Raise your hand. And yet, how many of us, including myself, have been in some situation on either side of another black person's aggression, or witnesses some form of queer or trans antagonism in black communities around some brother, queer, trans, or straight, who rocks all manner of Black Lives Matter t-shirts, even as he treats women and our femme-focused property less than objects, nothings? You get my point? Some of us will to believe that the only black lives worth fighting for are those that are lived by cisgender, heterosexual black men, and sometimes black, queer, bi men, but even those of us who identify as such can easily be sexist, trans antagonistic, elitist. We are all in this thing together. And if you don't believe me, ask our black trans sisters who continue to be killed without the sound of many heavy feet pounding some city's pavement. Killed without without names stitched to hashtags present in our social media feeds. If you don't believe me, I'd love for you to talk to the many young LGBTI, I for intersex, and gender non-conforming black youth I met throughout my lifetime, who have been kicked out of their homes, forced to fend for themselves in cities where some black pastors might publicly acknowledge support for same-sex marriage equality, while having yet to ordain a queer trans person in their congregation. If you don't believe me, Ask any of the cis or trans sisters from Ferguson to Chicago to Baltimore to LA, I know because I talked to them, who might possibly face the barrel of a police officer's gun for us, be pepper sprayed for us, face arrest for us, while also facing men who touch without permission, perform sex without consent, remind them of their place, even as they say Black Lives Matter. If you don't believe me, ask my mom, who after giving birth to me at 16 in Camden, New Jersey, was told by her father that raising her child at home would need to take precedence over her finishing her education. A male child who would go on to obtain a high school diploma and 3 degrees before she would even obtain her GED. If you don't believe me, consider the possibility that many folk who shape our culturally and spiritually rich Black institutions have made names we may not know, whose narratives may never appear in the books we read, whose legacies may never be the rationale for a newly minted lecture series, simply because they aren't straight, are gender-conforming, men, are respectable college graduates, are able-bodied, are without a prison record, are comfortable wearing clothes typically ascribed to boys and men. These concerns I am listing are not simply about conforming to a set of identity politics that is more symbolic and ceremonial representation than material equity. I'm not talking about brand indifference because it's the sexy thing to do in a culture that feeds on spectacle and Black commodity, right? It's not enough to say this iteration of the movement for Black lives is largely led by queer, trans, or women folk. It's not enough to do that. While it might be true that queer, trans, gender non-conforming folk and women might be more visible, which, if true, is arguably the result of our need to force ourselves and our narratives into histories that would otherwise function as our grave sites. It's also true that this movement is founded in principles of non-hierarchical forms of leadership, coalition, and solidarity. We are all in this thing together. White supremacy, capitalist patriarchy doesn't have any favorites. We are all targets, all of us. But even radical collectives can be emptied of shared power when the collective, meaning all the Black people represented in them, is organized by the priorities of even some of us. A true and radical Black politics of liberation must be grounded in a vision that begins with an assessment of those Black lives which daily survive at the edges of the margins. Who are those Black folk who are closest to the edge? Closest to the fist or gun of a rogue police officer. Closest to the jail cell. Closest to be sexually assaulted or misgendered after being locked up. Closest to diseased public order. Closest to economic disenfranchisement. Closest to ICE immigration removal. Closest to forced removal from their homes. Closest to the unemployment line. Closest to the gaze of those too willing to commit sexual assault. Closest to death by HIV. Closest to the altar with spit falling from their mouths as they pray for deliverance from demons no more real than Joy Zimmerman's claim of fear of closest to invisibility. Who are those Black folk that are closest to the edge? And what do we need to do to ensure these Black lives do not fall into a web of interconnected forms of structural oppression? What are we going to do to ensure that these Black lives, these Black people, these Black bodies are free? We will not get free, woke, or liberated. We will never be all right, okay, or better until those deemed the least among us are positioned to receive material equity. I am not talking about cheap talk. I am not talking about cheap grace. not symbolic inclusiveness, but real, tangible freedom. When trans black women are no longer killed by our hands, when queer, trans, and gender non-conforming young people are no longer put out of homes, are beholden to ontologically violent policies in our institutions, when we stop imagining the route to freedom as a long road to be walked, forgetting that some of the blacks can't walk at all because they are wheelchair bound, when we begin to vision and build these realities, we will have begun our movement toward collective care and liberation. In simpler terms, we cannot forget our people, all of our people. If black lives really matter to us, if all black lives really matter to us, we would never allow some of those lives to be discovered and easy to forget. So let me step back, because I've done it. A short time after Mike Brown was killed on August 9th, 2014, I received a text from my friend Darius. He too lives in Brooklyn. It was 4 a.m. His text read, "I can't sleep, I'm mad as hell, and I want to do something." In the quiet darkness of the early morning, we decided we would figure out a way to get to Ferguson so that we could join the black folk in St. Louis who had taken to the streets in protest. We wanted to join them in solidarity. Patrice Cullors Khan, who along with Alicia Garza and Nopa Tometi created the Black Lives Matter hashtag, had been in conversation with organizers on the West Coast about the same. They wanted to do the same thing. So they started planning too. Soon enough, a dream conceived in the midst of despondency and righteous indignation was a seed for what would become the Black Lives Matter riots in Ferguson, co-organized by myself, Patrice, and a host of folk from across the country. We organized all of this virtually in 2 weeks, never meeting. We lacked resources, even though people like Monica Dennis, Tamara Lewis, James Rome, Wendy Palacios worked nearly full-time over the course of 2 weeks to organize what would turn into a contemporary freedom ride to Ferguson. Our aims were very simple. We were committed to showing up to build alongside the people of St. Louis who had ushered in a new and urgent spirit of black radical protest. More than 500 people drove from places across the country and many traveled internationally. Groups arrived on buses and vans from LA, Atlanta, Tennessee, New York City, Boston, North Carolina, Toronto, and elsewhere. We wanted to bring our gifts and energies to a local movement without being additional distractions to their work. And we envisioned the gathering as a collective of all black bodies. We seemed determined to center the most marginalized black folk among us and reiterated constantly that this gathering would not be the place where people would experience invisibility. How could it when one of the national organizers was a black cis queer woman and the other was a black cis queer man? This black freedom gathering, we said, would be freedom. We were forced to accept a valid critique, though. Our black trans sisters told us it took immense courage for them to show up in spaces dominated by black cisgender people and our ideas. They reminded us about that most black collective space is still violent to them and oppressive because they tend to be organized and overrun by people who are not transgender. They reminded Patrice and I that black trans women were dying at alarming rates, often at the hands of black men, and that femme and non-gender conforming black folk are just as susceptible to violence. They questioned our commitment, my commitment, to true inclusion and liberation if, in fact, the lead planning group lacked their representation. And you know what? They were right. We imagined and organized a radical black gathering for liberation that was myopic. It was restrictive for some because of both our willful and advertent focus on liberation through the imagination of cisgender people. As a result, our mission was shaded by a lack of attention to the specificity of all black lives and a restricted black collective imaginary. What was designed as a freedom gathering actually left some of the black people in attendance feeling less free. It wasn't an easy critique to take in, but we had to. The most radical act one can commit to is to ensure that her, his, their politics and behaviors are shaped by a practice of self-reflexive analysis.
Come on.
Somebody say that. Self-reflexive.
Come on, Darnell.
Radicality means locating the I in the intersection where all of our lives and oppressions converge. Liberation requires heavy lifting, and sometimes the heaviest weights to lift or have removed are our desires, our pride, hatred, and biases. This work is more difficult than calling out oppressive practices, engaging in policy change, or leading community organizing efforts, because it requires, as one of my master students put it, internal abolition. The sound of the term abolition rolling off our lips is like the drum beat of revolution. Abolition is the spirit that moved Nat Turner to rebel and Harriet Tubman to break free. We imagine abolition then as a detonation of material chains. Prison abolition is in vogue but we must also be ready to embrace a form of psychic and ideological abolition too. What will it take to break the chains of oppression that choke our radical imaginations and politics? Did you know gender is a prison? It needs to be abolished. Did you know that patriarchy is actually a prison? It too needs to be abolished. I'm sure you know that white supremacy is a prison. It needs to be abolished. But so too is respectability a prison. And it needs to be abolished. But it is never easy to locate oneself in a matrix of oppression, only to discover that after we have identified, called out the feet that are placed on our necks, we are told that our feet, our wheelchair wheels, are squarely placed on the necks of some black person. The removal of our feet or our wheelchair wheels is love work. I recently wrote an essay titled, "You Are Not My Leader If You Don't Love Me," and I firmly believe that a sentiment to be true. Don't you dare call yourself my leader if you don't love me, especially when so many of us love you fiercely. Have you ever loved a thing that refused to love you back?
Come on, son.
So many black, cis and trans women fight for the liberation of those of us men who, because of our sexism and misogyny, might attack or refuse to fight for them. And you know why they do it? Because they love us.
Yeah. Come on.
So many queer and trans folk have taken arrests, been shot with rubber bullets, doused with tear gas into their eyes and skin, are irritated for black, cisgender, heterosexual folk who would sooner condemn us to hell or jail. But you know why they did it? Because they love us.
Talk about it.
And yet some of us have yet to realize how expensive this type of black radical collective love is. You don't even get it. This was the type of love that Rustin's life and work exemplified. It is a type of love that the queer, trans, or gender non-conforming students on this campus evidence. It is a type of love that moved Morehouse alum like Reverend Dr. Horace Griffin to go on to write the seminal text, "Their Own Receive Them Not, African American, Lesbian, and Gays in Black Churches," which compelled black churches to repent of this. This is the love that fuels the scholarship and teaching of people like Dr. Jafari Sinclair Allen, another Morehouse alum. So much so he returned to develop and teach a genealogy of black LGBTQ culture and politics on his campus. This is the love that has inspired alums like Jamal Lewis here, also known as Batman, and Kendrick Day, artists, thinkers, organizers who may have had to battle a web of forces just to get out of here, to go out into the world and be game-changing architects of our collective liberation. How dare we not love Russell? How dare we not love Drs. Griffin and Allen? How dare we not love Jamal and Kendrick? How dare we not celebrate their contributions to the project of our collective liberation? And how dare we register our appreciation by confining our remembrance and celebration of their works and lives to any space other than the center? Who would have thought that those we deem deviant would be the key to our collective liberation. Brothers, sisters, on this campus, I see and applaud you. To those of you who have taken a stance of accomplice in the lives of queer, trans, and gender non-conforming folk on this campus, and I say accomplice, not ally, because accomplice means you are willing to give some stuff up. You're willing to lose something, some access, some friends, some stuff, some position, some applause for the gain of collective liberation. I see and I applaud you. Yours is the example of what we must follow. And if we who seek freedom really desire it, we will not take hold of a black, we must take hold of a black, queer, trans, feminist political vision grounded in justice for the disabled, for the criminalized, for the sex worker, for the person living with HIV, for the community college student, for folk who dropped out before they could attain their high school diploma, for the cussing, pants sagging, or dress wearing brother, or the sister who refuses that form of identification, for the wheelchair bound or neurodivergent, for the bad girls and the hood boys. We are in this together, y'all. And it will take all of us to be free. Do black lives matter to you? Do black lives matter to you? Do black lives matter to you? Which black lives matter to you? Which black lives matter to you? Peace.
Feel free to stay behind and get engaged a little bit. Thank you for coming.